In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you like to have a seat? Good evening, everyone. It is great to be with you. I'm so grateful to be here in your diocese. Did you know that you are blessed? Good. I'm glad. Because your bishop, Bishop Brewer, is a gift to our church. Bishop Brewer has three of my favorite things in a bishop. First, he's a lover of Jesus. Have you noticed this? Have you noticed that he loves Jesus kind of like a lot? And so I love it that in Bishop Brewer, I have a father in God, but also a brother in Christ. That's a good thing. Second thing I love about him is that he's mission-minded. He's ready to try new things, take new ground. He wants to see us move forward and not backwards, and that's a great thing. Here's my third favorite thing about him, is that he loves you. Did you know this? Clergy, he loves you. That's my favorite thing about a bishop. Have you ever known a bishop that didn't love his clergy? You don't have that in Bishop Brewer. And I'm really happy for you that's true. So, sir, thank you for this opportunity. And it's I'm grateful to you value you more than you could know. I'm also glad to be here. I send you greetings on behalf of Bishop Curry, our presiding bishop. In case you don't know who I am, my name is Mike Mickey. I am the, are you ready for this? Staff Officer for Church Planting Infrastructure. Ooh, yes, that's what I do. I'll go around the country helping people start new churches and new mission enterprise zones. I'm also really excited that finally, at last, Father Mickey gets to preach in the Diocese of Central Florida. If you take a look at my ears have basically been this size since I was 6 years old. So if you have ears this big and a last name like Mickey, it's hard. Hard, I'm telling you. So rather than like keep Mickey out of my life, I've embraced Mickey into my life. Have you ever heard people criticize big churches, especially say, you know, that's a spiritual Disney World? Have you heard this before? Anytime anybody says that, I'm like, yes, that's great. Disney World, a place where people stand in line to get in, where the landscaping's always perfect, there's never any chipped paint, and everybody always cares about how the guests are doing. May our churches be more like Disney World. Don't get me started. And when Bishop Brewer told me that the theme for your conference this year is evangelism, embracing your neighborhood, I got really excited because church planters are really good at that. That's what we do for a living, embrace our neighborhoods. Just imagine yourself, I'm going to really try not to fall down these stairs. Just imagine if you were starting your church from scratch in your mission field, in the city where you live. Imagine if you woke up in, say, Nick Braunschneider's shoes, having to start a church out of nothing in Lake Nona, right? What would you do? How would you advise a church planter to start something from scratch? You had no building, no history, no people, no nothing. What would you do? How would you engage your neighborhood? Is your church that you're in today operating like that? Would you advise a church planter to operate like your church operates and exists in the mission field? I went to meddling. See how fast I went there, just straight to meddling. Would you do that? And if not, why not? And I think it's totally fitting, and I just love it, that we're talking about the conversion of the Apostle Paul this evening. Because Paul knew what it was like to get stuck in his ways. And I think sometimes in churches, we can get stuck in our ways. Would you agree with that? Say yes. We can be friends in here tonight, right? Right? We do get stuck in our ways sometimes. If you would like to take your bulletin out, look at page 3 in your bulletin. I'm going to go to the reading from the book of Acts. And if you look, and what Paul is doing here is he's before King Agrippa. And he's in Caesarea on his way to Rome making his defense. And so this is like a legal defense in front of King Agrippa. Are you with me so far? And if you look at this first paragraph, what he's telling King Agrippa is basically, I've been stuck in my ways. And he has this incredible encounter on the road, on the road to Damascus, and he's changed. It takes a higher power than yourself to get you stuck when you're stuck in your ways, to get you unstuck. Have you experienced this? Like for me, I'm the third of four kids. And my formative years were in Charlotte, North Carolina. And as a kid growing up, my parents never took me to Disney World. Aww. You know where we went? Caruthersville, Missouri, where my grandma Hawkins lived. And y'all, we had a 1975 Chrysler Town and Country station wagon. Anybody remember this? This bad boy was blue, and it had like sticky tape around it that made you think it had wood paneling. Remember this car? It had a 400 V8. It allegedly could go 0 to 60 in 14.1 seconds. This thing had a luggage rack on the top. If it had seat belts in the back seat, I do not remember. One thing I can tell you for sure is it didn't have Wi-Fi. It didn't have a screen for movies. Our particular model didn't even have an 8-track player. Another favorite feature of mine, of our town and country, was it had in the rear of the car, it had the third seat, rear-facing third seat. You could, like, lift it up by this little latch, and it would, like, face backward. So that was our car. And when we go from Charlotte to Caruthersville, these trips, let me tell you what they were. They were a battle. A battle for justice, for territory, and for personal rights. Right? That's what they were. And in the back seat, I don't know if you can picture this, but like I remember the back seat being vinyl, but there was like this little extra thicker strip of vinyl that came down, like that was vertical, right, for decoration. But what it meant for us kids in the back seat, those were like the wall, man. That was territory. Like, don't go past the vinyl strip. This is mine. And when we got, you know, if my brother, get to your side, right? And I would love it. Love it. I would pray that my mom would, like, banish me to the back. That's what we called the third seat and the rear-facing back. Banish me to the back where I could sit alone and look back at where we've been. Literally have my back to my brothers and sisters. And there'd be times when it would get so bad that my mom, bless her heart, surely under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, would turn around to the kids in the back and she'd say, there's room in the station wagon for everybody. Central Florida, listen to me. This is my sermon. This is the message that I came all the way from Texas to give you. Are you ready? This is what Bishop Brewer sent me here to tell you. Are you ready? Say yes. Here's my sermon. There's room in the station wagon for everybody. Say it with me. There's room in the station wagon for everybody. I wonder, think about you and think about your church. Just don't make a face. Just look at me. It's okay. Think about you and think about your church. Are you or your church like me sitting in that station wagon, existing only for yourself, only trying to protect yourself and your sense of space? Or even worse, were you like me in the back with your back to your brothers and sisters looking at where you've been and not where you're going? Right? Friends, there's room in the station wagon for everybody. If you feel that way, right? If your church feels that way, I want you to embrace the words of the prophetess Julie from Caruthersville, who would want you to know there's room in the station wagon for everybody. She wanted me to get unstuck from my selfish ways. Well, that's how I got unstuck. Let's take a look at how Paul got unstuck. I understand I have an hour and a half to preach. Is that right? Is that right? Good. Get comfortable. Relax. Don't worry, it'll be fine. Page 3, do you have it? Say, I've got it. Okay, look at this. We said paragraph 1 is, I'm stuck in my ways. Then the next paragraph, we see the first thing about how this change happens in Paul. The first thing I want you to know that his change is instant. It's instant. He tells King Agrippa, with this in mind, I was traveling to Damascus, look at this, with the authority and commission of the chief priests. Poor Paul. What was he doing? He was only doing what he thought the institution wanted him to do. He was being his good religious self. And he was moving in that authority. But what was he? He was stuck in his ways. And I love this. He mentions that when at midday, when the sun is the highest at the sky, in the heat of the day, beloved, aren't you tired of working for yourself, only internally, stuck in your ways in the heat of the day? This is how some of us are. And what I love, I just love what Jesus does for Paul here. He's in the heat in his religiousness, and he sees a light from heaven, brighter than the sun. If you read the account earlier in the book of Acts, he literally gets knocked off his high horse, doesn't he? The voice comes shining around him. They're on the ground, and Jesus speaks up, says, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he says, it hurts you to kick against the goads. Do you know what a goad is? Goats, like imagine a guy walking behind an ox, right? And he's got this stick that he has. And on the point of the stick, kind of like a verger stick a little bit. You can use this, right? You got to put imagine a pointy needle at the end of a verger stick. That's kind of what it was. Wouldn't you love that? Wouldn't that be great? Every verger would love that. Anyway, a stick. And so when the yoke came upon the oxen, what would the oxen do? It would kick against that yoke. And when the ox would kick, the guy would put the goad into the heel of the ox to teach the ox to submit. And what Jesus is saying here is, Paul, you're kicking against the goads. There's a yoke I've put upon you, and you need to stop resisting it. Listen, that's what we need to do as the church, amen? Is that what's our pain? Our pain isn't the goads, but our pain, listen, I go all around the country and I see this. Our pain in the Episcopal Church right now is decline. And not starting new church, but opening new churches. How long will we kick against the goads in our religiosity and finally submit to Jesus? Is Jesus the Lord of your neighborhood? Is this microphone on? Check. 1, 2. Check. Testing. Is Jesus the Lord of your neighborhood? Yes. If he is, then you can trust him. You can submit to his yoke. He will show you the way to reach, to embrace your neighborhood. And I love this, that Paul, this happens to Paul. They don't say, okay, Jesus didn't say, okay, so what I want you to do, Paul, is make a committee and do a 10 to 15 year strategic plan. Is that what it says? No. This happens to Paul instantly. When my mom said, there's room in the station wagon for everybody, when did she want me to get it? 10 exits later? No. Instantly. Central Florida, hear me. You, in your heart. You, in your church. You, collectively, as a diocese. You know when you can make this change? Look at me. You know when you can make this change? Right? Good. Do it instantly. Next thing is it's internal. If you notice, there's a lot of stuff going on in this passage, right? There's the light, there's the voices, there's the road, there's the horses, people everywhere. Stuff is going on, right? But the main thing that happens to Paul here isn't an external thing. It's what? It's an internal thing that happens in him, right? This is what my mom wanted for me when there's room in the station wagon for everybody. She wanted my heart to change toward my brothers and sisters. You know who your brothers and sisters are. Have you read, remember the parable of the Good Samaritan? Who's your brother and sister, right? Your neighbor, right? He wanted this change to happen in my heart. And he says, and this passage just knocks me out. He says, I'm Jesus who you're persecuting. You see me, I'm right there in the middle. He goes, but get up and stand on your feet. Listen, I talk to clergy all over the country, talk to almost every bishop in the Episcopal Church, and almost every one of them asked me, what should we do for mission? get up and stand on your feet. That's all you got to do, beloved. Walk in your calling. There's something amazing that happens with Paul, and this is consistent in Paul's teaching, is that your calling is resident in your conversion. Your calling comes with your conversion. Do you believe this? Listen, if you're a delegate here, if you in this convention, or if you're an ordained person, you've all been confirmed. Who here's been confirmed? Anybody not been confirmed? We can change that tonight too. Okay. Good answer. If you've been confirmed, think of this with me. You've had hands laid on you by a bishop in apostolic succession. Did you know that? That something was imparted in you in that moment. It doesn't matter if you feel it. It's there. How many of you know this Christianity stuff? It's like almond joy and mounds. Sometimes you feel like a nut. Sometimes you don't. Sometimes you'll feel closer to Jesus, sometimes you won't. This calling, though, is true. It's there. It's in you. It's time for you to get up, stand up, and start walking in it. And look at the calling that Jesus gives Paul here. It's amazing. And I know we're Episcopalians and we're supposed to be like somber and like reserved and severe, but I just get a little happy when I read this stuff. Can I be happy about this? Is this okay with you? Look at the bottom of this paragraph here. Because you see that last sentence on the bottom of page 3? I will rescue you from your people and the Gentiles. Here's the part that makes me happy. To whom I am sending you. What he's saying, my message, is the thing that Jesus has done in my life, in my heart. Just let me testify to you. This has all happened to me, that you can open their eyes. I once was blind, but now I. So that they may turn from darkness to light. Listen, I was in darkness. Jesus says in the Gospel of John, remember, I did not call you. You did not seek me, but I sought you to ordain you so that you may do good works. I once was in darkness, but Jesus, by his loving kindness, brought me out of that darkness into from the power of Satan to God. I'm playing for a different team than I used to play, thanks be to God, so that they may receive the forgiveness of sins. Do you know what a blessing we're about to have if I ever get done preaching? We're going to have this confession, aren't we, I think? We're going to do no, we won't. But on church on Sunday, you're going to... Maybe we will. Hold on. We will. Good. All right. This bishop is going to do the absolution. Do you get what a powerful thing that is? That baggage of sin that you're carrying around. I watched some of you walk into church this morning. And you were like this. Because you've got this unforgiven sin that you're just carrying around. You don't need to carry that anymore. Why? Because your sins have been forgiven. 1 John, right? If you say you have no sin, you are a liar and the truth is not in you. But if you are faithful and just to confess your sins, if you'll confess your sins, Jesus is faithful and just to forgive you your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Do you believe that? You've got forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. Don't get me even talking about heaven. Man. This thing is an internal thing that happens in Paul. All this happened in his heart, and it's happened in my heart and in your heart, I hope. Right? Beloved, hear me, please. Your mission field does not need one more external show of your religiosity. What they need is a show of your internal conversion to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what they need. Listen, people in our mission field, they drive by our churches, they look at the buildings, they see the stained glass, they take a look at our fancy vestments, and you know what they say? I could never go in a place like that. I'm not good enough to go in a place like that. And even if I was, I probably don't have the right shoes, so I just can't go. They need us to convert with a converted heart to go out, not just to bring them in, but to be with them where they are. Here's my last thing, and I'll sit down. So it's instant, internal. Last one is indelible. Say indelible. You know, there were times in the car that we got it, where it was awesome. There were times in the Mickey family in that old town and country where it was joyous. We'd be singing songs and laughing. I remember my dad, Lord rest him. We'd go under these tunnels under the Smoky Mountains. Ever been under in one of those? And whenever we went in those tunnels, he'd turn on the headlights and he'd honk his horn all the way through there. And we'd laugh. Other times we'd like be driving through the mountains and one of us would call out, "Scenic vista on the right." That was the thing we all did. Everybody look and enjoy the view. Scenic vista. Listen, some of the happiest memories in my childhood were in that car. I don't remember really being in it daily. I'm sure I was. But what I remember is the big trips and those moments. And it'd be great, but guess what? Pretty soon, my brother'd go across the vinyl line and it'd be on again. We would lose it. But this change Jesus wants to do in us is not like that. And it wasn't like that for Paul, right? Carefully look at what he tells King Agrippa, the last paragraph. He goes, "After that, Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision." The change was indelible. It was permanent. This was my mother's dream, that we would forever have our hearts changed one to another. This is an indelible change. Listen, like ink into paper. It's a new way of living. Listen, and for us, for you as an individual, for your church, your institution, for the Diocese of Central Florida, hear me. It's the indelible decision to live and act and minister no longer for yourself, but for your mission field. Your church does not exist for the people who are in it, but for the people who are not there yet. Listen, why would you go another year around the programmatic track living for yourself? How long, oh Lord, how long will you sit with your back to the mission field in the back, looking at where you've been and longing for it, rather than turning around to the mission field and seeing, "Jesus, what adventure are you taking me to yet?" Am I making sense up here? Say yes. You remember the song, "I Have Decided," I'm not gonna sing it, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus"? No turning back. Though, you say, "Well, we gotta have a vestry meeting." No, "though none go with me, yet I will follow." No turning back. The past behind me, the cross before me. No turning back. Hear me, Central Florida. The metaphorical Chrysler is parked outside, gassed up, and ready to go. And my prayer for you is that you would leave this place, leave this convention, and follow our Lord Jesus to every town and to every country that he calls you to. This Jesus, he did it for Paul, he did it for me, and he'll do it for you. Let's say it together. There's room in the station wagon. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.